And if there be any word good for the use of edifying, give it, thou mayest minister grace to the hearers. Grant that I may speak boldly. I have my mouth wide, O Lord, do thou fill it. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Last week we spoke of Adam. This week we move on to Abraham. What then shall we say about Abraham? Let's dig in. Abraham believed God, and it was reckoned to him as righteousness. And when I first think of this statement, I think of the faith of Abraham, who is willing to trust God enough, even to the point of sacrificing Isaac, the son of the prophet. And I remember one time when my father and I were sitting down and talking about this. And he's not normally one to emote. He's a Marine, big tough guy. And I think I've seen him cry out three times in my life. This is one of them. So he looked at me with tears in his eyes. And he said, how could a father ever be willing to do that to his son? And I can't even barely talk about it and think about it without getting a little choked up myself. It was a very touching and emotional moment between the two of us. Abraham was so convicted of God's promises by this point that he knew that if God wanted his son sacrificed, that he would somehow bring him back to life. Anything to fulfill his promise to Abraham of making him a great nation. So, at this point in the story, it's a bit too late for St. Paul to talk about it being reckoned as Abraham as righteousness for his trust and faith, because at this point he had already experienced God many times. He even felt so comfortable with God that he was willing to take to stretch out and beg with God for the lives of the people in Sodom, to plead and barter with him to try to get God's wrath away from Sodom. So this incident is different than St. Paul is talking about. St. Paul is actually talking about Abraham's response to God before anything took place at all. Right before our lesson today, we get the generations of terror. It's a narrowing device, but it also speaks about Terah, Abraham's father. And St. Stephen, in the Acts of the Apostles, he tells us a bit about Terah, that he was a pagan. Yes, he was in the line of Shem, Noah's good son. He was in this line, but he didn't know God. He was a pagan. And so he raised his son as a pagan. So when God appeared to Abraham, and he says, go to a land that I will tell you, sight unseen, go there. The faith that he has in this God whom he is just meeting for the first time, this is the faith that St. Paul is talking about, because he takes up everything. Except his wife, his nephew Lot, his heir, and all of his household, and he moves 500 miles away into an unknown country. He goes exactly where God told him, because he says, go from your country and take all your kindred and your house and to the land that I will show you. And to his credit, Abraham went as the Lord told him. He does exactly what he said. He doesn't say but. He picks up and goes. This is the faith that St. Paul is talking about. And at this point in his life, Abraham should have been able to sit back and relax. He's 75 years old. You know, he doesn't have a whole lot to get left to experience in life or a normal person's lifespan. Moses says the man's life is 80 years. And so he's got 75, he's got, by all estimations, 5 years left. And so he's almost at the point of death right now. He's just waiting And so we shouldn't expect him to then be willing to pick up everything and go into a land that is not known to him. Yet, this is exactly what happens. He took his wife, his nephew, and all of their possessions and moved 500 miles away. He had no more safety net. He was flying by the seat of his pants. Excuse me. He was all in at this point. He was all in merely on the promises of God, a God whom he had just met. This is the faith that Abraham builds up. Abraham, seemingly at the end of his life, faced certain death in a land of uncertainty. Yet St. Paul says, our God is one who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. So for Abraham, though the world was telling him he had nothing left to do in his life but wait to die, God says, out of death, I will give you life. Out of all of this, I will call into you a new life. Out of nothing, if you will only but listen to me. And so, Abraham did not know what to expect. Yet all he had was his trust. He placed his trust in God, took a deep breath, and took the plunge. Now today, we would all call that impulsive. And we would probably chastise Abraham for taking such a chance. You're 75 years old. You don't need to be doing such life-changing things. You don't need to do all this. You can sit back and rely on the system that you have set up. You have an heir. You have everything supposed to, he's going to take care of you. Everything can happen now. You can just sit back, drink Arnold Palmer's, play golf, do what you need to sit back and enjoy. Yet, we would call this impulsive, but Scripture, sadly, is silent on the theophany Abraham received when God introduced himself. I would like to think that when God appeared to Abraham, there would be no doubt afterwards as to who was calling him, and that he would just say, yes, sir, on anywhere you want to send me. You want me to go live in the bottom of the ocean? But yes, sir, having just met God. And two, we normally like to play things on the safe side, but that's not what God is calling Abraham to do. We would say, why take risks? Well, we're all well established, and we haven't done it this way for a long time. We've done it this way for a long time, where we've never done this. See, the problem with this statement is, we've done it this way forever, is that this statement fails to recognize that at one point, there was a time when this could not be said. It could not have been said, well, we've always done it this way, because it was the first time. A risk had to be taken once upon a time. Institutions that no longer take risks are already dead. And as Danny DeVito says in Other People's Money, they're dead. They just haven't run out of money. Institutions that no longer take risks are dead. They just haven't run out of money. This is what Jesus points to Nicodemus when he comes as a Jew, as an institution that is in the presence of God, yet fails to notice them. They are dead, yet they just haven't run out of money yet. He comes to them and he asks Jesus for advice. And Jesus tells them he must be born of the Spirit. He says, that which is born of flesh is flesh. And that which is born of the Spirit is spirit. How can you expect spiritual fruits when you're only operating in a fleshly world? If at any point a church backs off on pushing forward, they have cut themselves off from the life and the Spirit and are coasting on the mammon of the flesh. I say this to the church, but it also applies to individuals as well. Abraham was was 75 years old. He had the opportunity to say, no, God, I can't possibly do this, I'm too old. And that's always the ability to us. God challenges us to do something hard. We say, no, I'm in a different point in my life. I'm here. Why do more when this is happening, when this is good enough? Yet, if Abraham had said that to God, he would never have made it to the promised land. He would never have seen the land that God promised. The salvation history as we know it would be utterly different. And this is proof enough that whenever God calls us to follow him, we are never too old or too young or too whatever to look at God and say no. At any age, whether individually or institutionally, we can always gather our possessions and follow where God wants us.